Giving you one one.
Okay, I'm calling to order this regularly scheduled public meeting of the IID Board. Would you please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance and stand? Mr. Lloyd Miller will lead us.
Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, and Gloria, for the record, the meeting was called to session approximately 5:14 p.m. Do we have any reports of actions in closed session, Mr. Taylor?
No, sir.
Board members have had taken the time to review the agenda. Looking for a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Please vote. Motion passes.
Oh, look at that.
5-0. Okay, at this time of our meeting, it's a time for public comments. And Mr. Taylor, I think you have an announcement.
Yes, sir. The public should be aware that we're shortening the public comment period down from 5 minutes to 3 minutes. And we're doing that so that we can guarantee that everyone has an opportunity to speak at the meeting.
Any public comments at this time?
Good evening, honorable board members, and welcome to all of you new directors, Director Kuhn, Director Galindo, and Director Benson. Last summer, I apologize, I'm Anastasia Mickey, representing the Hopeful Athletic Club and IVDA, which is Imperial Valley Desert Aquatics. Last summer, the ECAC committee made a very large donation, which enabled us to put a thermal heater at the pool in Hopeville, which has created a second year-round swim team. So now we have not only the north end, but the entire south end covered for swim teams. So any of you have children that want to be on a year-round swim team, you're more than welcome in Hopeville, thanks to the IID. We now have warm water. So I had the children, well, these aren't exactly children, but I had the children get together and make painted thank yous for all of you. So Gloria does actually have several various stages of artistic ability, but all very true and thankful. But we did frame our two favorites, and the children signed them for you. Ms. Bradshaw?
IID board members, I am the daughter of David and Dee Bradshaw. I'm a sophomore at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and I grew up swimming here, and it was always a big commute to Brawley. So thank you for making this possible so students now have a better opportunity to succeed in the swimming career if they choose.
Hello, board members. My name's Evan. I'd like to thank you for installing the solar panels because it allows Hopeville High School to possibly swim there. It's really grown like a large public awareness to the fact that we do have a swim team, and hopefully this year there's more than one.
I'd watch the Ivy Press because Hopeville is going to kick some booty this year. We went from one swimmer, which was Brooke, and then Evan when she went off to college, to now we have 15 swimmers started, and we're looking for a coach, which is very exciting. Never would have happened without your generous donation. So I thought perhaps if you'd like to come out and take a picture with the Bradshaws. If you don't mind, careers. Yes, I know. Thank you, Director Kuhn. Thank you very much.
Okay, additional public comments, Mr. Ramos.
Yeah, Tony Robinson's resident. Matt, you know, you took me for a loop. I really feel you guys should go back to 5 minutes. I don't think that even in the 10 years that I've been coming here, 5 minutes caused any problems. By doing 3 minutes, it really stalls things. The public waits a whole week to come here and speak. Sometimes 3 minutes isn't enough time. And I was going to speak of another thing. Now I have to tuck my 3 minutes into convincing you guys to go back to 5 minutes. It's really going to cause any problems. Not at all, really. And I think, I hope you guys reconsider it, because by doing this, it almost seems like, well, we got a new board, new ideas. We're going to go to what you want, not what the public wants. And I really feel you should consider that. What he said right now, to give more comments and more space and more time, it's not true. I mean, I was here before this kid even was born, you know, and I know what I'm talking about. You know, it's a really shallow excuse to use to allow more people to come here to speak more time. I think 5 minutes is perfect. I wait a whole week to come here, and I already used a minute and a half of my time when I was going to talk about why Garber isn't here, and it's cut into my space and that. So I hope you give me 5 minutes, Mr. President, because I'm used to that, and I hope you give everybody else a 5 minutes. It's a nice, the legal, and it's the proper thing to do, because we're used to that. And beyond that, you know, I do want to say that, why is Mr. Garber not here today, sitting here in place of Mr. Taylor? Can anybody answer that?
Yeah, this is your time for comment, Mr. Ramos.
Oh, then that's all, it's going to be no comment then,
no,
right?
Mr. Ramos, it's at my direction that Mr. Taylor sit in
well,
for Mr.
Okay.
Garber.
Well, I hope it doesn't go back to what happened 5 months ago when Scaroni was here, and he said that when he gets his people in, which is Galindo, Mr. Benson, and Mr. Kuhn, that they're going to fire Mr. Garber and Mr. Kale. I hope it's not true, because, you know, this is a public entity, a public agency, a nonprofit. Nobody can have an agenda and fire and place people and get people to work. If I wanted to get my son to work, he'd have to wait in line. And I feel that by cutting into 3 minutes, not having Garber here, it cuts into what you people were saying. It's going to be your way or the highway, and it's not right. You know, the other thing too, Mr. Kuhn, you praised or defended the whistleblower, the guy that took emails from Mr. Menville. You know, that guy, Mr. Menville, trusted that guy. He went to his home to do that. He never told me who he is, and that's a felony. That guy should go to jail, that he should be prosecuted. You know, you would prosecute a robbery if he went to your home. This is no different. This is a white-collar crime, and nobody on the board should defend him. You know, I think it's illegal. I don't think that by swearing and the oath you took Friday to defend the Constitution, by you doing that, you're not defending the Constitution. And, you know, and then you thanked, Mr. Kuhn, you thanked the Abadis, you thanked Jerry Ghana, and you said you never knew who Ivy First was, who belonged to Ivy First, and now you know, and they were helping you all this time, you know. So I don't know where you're coming from, Mr. Kuhn, and I hate to pick on you, but you're used to my picking, because we go back 10 years on this, and I really feel that it's bad that you sit there and take an oath, and then you defend a guy that ended up stealing and
that's,
defrauding
that's 3 minutes,
and menacing
Mr.
with, yes, Mr. and menacing with the likes of Mr. Menville. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Matt.
Ramos.
I hope you reconsider that. Thank you.
Any more public comments? Okay, we'll go to the board for comments. I'll go to Board Director Hanks first.
It's been a long day. I'm going to pass.
Director Kuhn?
I would just like to say that Saturday I had a conversation with Steve Sharp, and I said, I wonder why Garber wasn't up there. And he was in the audience. And I thought, well, maybe he took a day off. So really hate getting accused by the newspaper of doing something underhanded when I didn't know. And I guess it really isn't up to my purview. But, you know, cheap shots been taken tonight. Cheap shots were taken Sunday. I don't get it. We did nothing. We didn't meet. We didn't do anything underhanded. So, anyway, it is what it is. I'm done.
Mr. Benson.
I just want to say it was great to have everyone that could make it here Friday, and this is our first open meeting with an agenda. Again, I'm open. If you guys need anything, feel free to call or email me. I've already met with a number of people, both pro and con Steve Benson. So there's lots of issues out there, and I think we all need to take into consideration. We have to weigh each decision that we vote on. Also, going forward, I'm looking to get involved in a lot of the water issues. There is a water meeting coming up in Las Vegas. We're leaving tomorrow, a couple of us, to go to the Colorado River Users Association. I'm not really sure what all these acronyms stand for, but we'll figure it out as we go. So look forward to it. Thanks.
And Director Norma Galindo.
Thank you. No comment, Mr. President.
Yeah, I just like to welcome the new board in. We had a swearing-in ceremony last Friday. It was very nice, went very smooth. We've had a full agenda today, full closed session, a full budget hearing, workshop, and now we have a public session we're going to, so it has been a long day. With that said, we'll go to the general manager for comments.
Yes, Mr. President, today I met in closed session with the reconstituted IID board to discuss key elements that will figure prominently in its evaluation of the general manager. This was, in my view, entirely fitting and proper and in conformity with the board's own governance model and the safe harbor provision under the Brown Act. Based on the input I received today, it is my intention to prepare and publish a program of work for next week's open session agenda that the board and public can review and comment on prior to what I hope will be its adoption. Coming out of closed session, I also want to report to the board, public, and our own employees that I will be issuing a memorandum this week to make plain that no staff member should have any misgivings about engaging directly with individual board members on matters of concern to him or her. As general manager, I am more interested in rooting out problems within the organization than I am in ferreting out leaks. I am also mindful that the board members are elected to serve their constituents, and employees don't stop being constituents simply because of where they work. So to sum up then, to the extent that there ever was such a gag order, it will cease to exist as of this week.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Vance, Mr. Taylor?
Yes, I'd just like to congratulate the new board members.
Thank you. Okay, with that, we're going to move into action. First, we need to take care of the election of the board president and the vice president. This takes us to page 34 of our agenda.
I would like to ask Gloria Rivera if this is consistent with our policy book. And it's my understanding it would, it's Director Desert's turn to be the president. You want a motion with them both at one time, or?
I think we'll just do them both together. It'll be Director Hanks will be sitting as vice president.
Do you need a nomination?
I make the motion.
Any discussion? Please vote. Very good. We're looking now at the appointment of the board secretary. That's page 38 of our agenda.
Make the motion that we appoint Gloria Rivera.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Please vote. Passes 5-0. Congratulations, Gloria. Appointment of our treasurer, page 39.
Make a motion to appoint Maria Caldera.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Please vote. And that passes 5-0 also. Okay, with that business taken care of, we're going to move into the consent area of our agenda. I spoke with a director that had some questions about these items as all the new board members are new. So I think it'd be prudent if we handled and dealt with each one of these individually. So the first item on the consent agenda is the approval of the November 13th, 2012 regular board minutes.
So moved.
Second.
I have a comment.
Yes.
I'm going to abstain since I was not present at that meeting, for the record.
Any other discussion?
No.
Please vote. Okay, item 5 is the approval of a 4-month extension to service agreement number 81-1405 with the Gualco Group for state legislative services. This item was presented to us last week in information to the old board. Mr. Guaco provides, and his firm provides services in Sacramento at the state's legislative area. At this time, the board is going out for an RFP for a new contract, which Mr. Guaco is more than welcome to bid on. So this is approval of a four-month extension, and the cost of the four-month extension is $50,000. Is that correct, Mr. Kelly?
Yes, sir.
$80,000. I'm sorry, Mr. Ortega.
Good evening, President, Desert, members of the board. Again, if you pretty much summed up the memo item, but if there are any questions, I am here to answer them. This is a continuation of our current agreement, but only for the time whereby we are at the same time reviewing the proposals that come in. At that time, when we do select a new lobbying firm or the current firm, for that matter, then we will obviously come back to the board with that recommendation. But due to both of these contracts expiring at the end of this month, we are asking for that time allowed or that extension.
I'll make the motion to approve.
That motion.
So there's a motion and a second to approve the four-month extension to the Guaco Group service contract.
I've got a question. Mr. Ortega, on the RFP, will that be energy and water together, or are we going to separate those out?
Well, what we've done is we've allowed that flexibility to have one or more lobbyists represent the district on either water or energy, and for also federal and state. So the way that the QRs were drafted, it was state and federal, but within the state services, again, there is that flexibility to allow one or more than one representative.
Okay. Will you be bringing us any recommendations? I mean, you're a little more in step with what goes on up there and as far as making recommendations on who should be representing us?
Correct. And that will be based on the proposals and the solicitations or the responses that are submitted back to IID. That deadline is December 19th. Currently there are bidders that are looking at the QRs and possibly going to submit their proposal, so we will review them as a committee. We will shortlist those, create an RFP, go through that process, and again, based on their qualifications and those highly qualified firms, we will come before your board with those recommendations.
Okay, and one last question. On this extension, will these two firms be appearing before us? Before the new RFP?
Yes, in the interval, they will both be making appearances.
Okay. I would appreciate that myself.
Yeah. Okay, so we're dealing with just the one firm, the Guaco firm, at this time. And if I heard you correct, Mr. Ortega, that the bidders for the RFP, so we may end up with two separate firms that handle these water and power issues for us rather than just one.
We may.
That availability is there for us to look at.
Correct. And again, we have, I believe, on the federal level, we used to have two different firms that represented us on energy water. Now we have the one, which is the next item. But again, with this QR that is out there publicly today, we do have that flexibility. And again, it will be based on those qualifications that meet that prior experience. As you know, there are many firms in Sacramento and DC that represent many different clients on different issues, but some have areas of expertise that are geared towards other industries. And if we feel that there is a discrepancy or that we can receive more highly qualified lobbying services, if we do choose to separate the energy from the water side, then I think that will be a recommendation to this board. But on the same token, if we feel that we would be best served by one in-house firm for both, then again, we will also make that recommendation.
Very good. Any further discussion from the board? Okay, call for the vote. Okay, that carries 4-1. And the next item is the approval of a four-month extension service agreement with the Ferguson Group at the federal legislative level.
This item is also just nearly identical to the prior item. The firm that represents IID in Washington, D.C. is the Ferguson Group, and their four-month extension would be $50,000 or up to $50,000 for that four-month period.
Okay, any comments from the board? Looking for a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the first
group. Motion from Mr. Month. Benson. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
A second from...
I'd just like to add, you know, it's a lot of money in a short term, but in a critical issues and situations that we're being faced with, not only with energy and water, it's important that we have a watchdog there to inform us of any developments.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Call for the vote. Thank you. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Okay, our last consent item is our second to the last, excuse me, acknowledge receipt of wire transfers, cash warrants report for November 2012. Any questions or comments from the board regarding the wire transfer records for November?
Make a motion to approve.
A motion from Director Hanks.
I'll second it, but I have discussion.
Second from
Director Benson. And discussion, Mr. Benson?
You know, when I was a member of the public and I would look at these, it's really hard to ascertain who gets paid what, especially when you just roll it off on a daily basis. And I didn't know if there's any way to break it down by categories. It'd be easier for me to review, and it'd be easier for the public to review, so they know we're not trying to hide anything on 50 pages of checks.
Yeah, it's just the check registers essentially what we're showing. We can take a look at that and get back to you on that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's been viewed in the past, but it's a good idea to refresh it. Perhaps we can come up with a different presentation.
Okay.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Call for the vote. Okay, motion passes. Thank you.
I did.
Let's vote again.
Oh, my bad.
And the last consent item is approval of amendment number 1 to service agreement number 81-1254 with Union Bank, extending said agreement from May 2013 to May 2015.
Is this the same terms we had last year?
Yes, same pricing and same service. We've been rather happy with the service.
Motion from Director Hanks. Is there a second?
I'll second.
From Director Kuhn. Discussion? Call for the vote. Okay, motion carries. Now we'll move into the regular information section of the agenda. This is item 9. This is a review comment on proposed board meeting calendar for 2013.
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, this proposed calendar is offered for your consideration. It does contemplate the elimination of the middle meeting, or the third meeting, and it's before you at the request of the president.
Yeah, so we took a look at the meeting agenda, and we've toned it back to the presentation tonight, which is two meetings a month. That does not necessarily mean we're going to stay with two meetings a month. We can schedule a special meeting or an emergency meeting as long as we follow those policies to do so. In consideration of the meetings in La Quinta, we're contemplating four at this time, perhaps two. When those meetings in La Quinta do take place, those are just power meetings, electrical meetings. We do not discuss water issues. So those months that happens, we will be calendaring another meeting for El Centro to cover those water issues. So we'll be having a complete two meetings a month of water and power in the El Centro auditorium. So it does seem like it's a shorter presentation for the meeting schedule, but we were looking at streamlining things here, picking up some efficiencies in the presentations and the processing by the board, also some efficiencies in the number of staff members that need to participate in the board meetings. Any questions from the board?
On the week that we meet in La Quinta, I would recommend that on those months that we have two meetings here so that we can get the water side taken care of. There'd be two meetings. Otherwise, there's just one. And with the issues of the conservation and litigation going on, I think we'll probably need them.
Okay, so the way the calendar is presented, it only has two meetings a month, and there's four meetings in La Quinta. Is that correct, Gloria?
Okay, the calendar has four meetings already scheduled.
Four in La Quinta?
Yes.
Quinta.
In La Quinta. But it's up to you, Director.
So we're talking about adding another four meetings during those months to the schedule.
That would be March, June, September, and December, Director Hanks, which are the months that we meet in La Quinta.
Yeah, two. Is that what you're looking at?
No.
Four.
The
quarterly meetings.
And then add?
And add another one.
Yeah, I would suggest, you know, we go to La Quinta, and we now have the video conferencing set up, and we travel that distance. A lot of times, the only people present are staff. I would suggest cut it back to two, and you know, we can always revisit that if necessary.
And then add a corollary meeting here in El Centro that same week.
Those two months, yeah, the following week. So do we want to pick the months that we're scheduling those two in discussion?
Maybe we can alternate the months.
Yeah, I'd propose we stay home in December. It's a busy time for everybody.
September. June
and December, maybe?
Yeah.
You want to do June and December or January and June?
Oh, put those back here, and then March and September, leave them in La Quinta.
So which months are you saying for La Quinta?
March and September.
March and September scheduled for La Quinta. We will have please schedule another meeting during those months here in El Centro. So that's the item. That's the way the calendar is being presented tonight and understood.
Those 2 months will have three meetings.
That's correct.
Yes.
You might very well have a called meeting at the president's request.
Okay. I'm sure there'll be need for special meetings besides the. Yeah.
Okay, any further comment on this?
I just have a question. Does La Quinta always have the ability to watch online or watch the video feed, or is it only certain events?
It's been used sparingly, but it can be done routinely.
And is there a cost to us, or is it just a straight feed?
It's
just someone up there staying there. And
it's basically somebody turning the system on and turning it off.
Okay, so looking for a motion for the agenda.
Oh, this is information.
Information only.
Very good.
So that'll come back to us for action. Thank you. Okay. Item 10, information comments by Attorney Tony Braun regarding designation of the partial participating transmission ownership status. Mr. Braun.
President Desert, board members, thank you very much. Management asked me to give an informational briefing on some of the ideas that are being considered to streamline the interconnection of renewable generation in and around the Imperial Valley substation, and I hope to do that in an expeditious manner. As you know, there's quite a bit of solar generation that's being considered in and around the IV substation, both south to be directly connected through SDG&E facilities and north and more pertinent to this discussion here today through some facilities where IID would own facilities that would streamline the interconnection of various solar generators north of the Imperial Valley sub. The basic description of what's being discussed is to have lines being approved through the California ISO process to be a collector system that would be called what the ISO calls policy-driven facilities. These facilities would be developed. They've already been permitted, is my understanding, and they'd actually be deeded over to IID, and then they would directly connect to IV substation, and they would be directly connected to the ISO balancing authority. This is advantageous from a development standpoint because it helps the developers get capacity credits for when they deliver under their contracts with could be San Diego Gas and Electric, it could be Southern California Edison, it could be Pacific Gas and Electric, and also it's advantageous to them as far as ongoing assessment of transmission charges. Key elements, again, the ISO management, because these facilities are less than $50 million, these do not need to go to the ISO board for approval. The ISO board is being briefed this Friday for informational purposes. So if there's any issues at the board, I presume they would be coming up there. But that's part of the checking the box process that ISO management has to go through, at which time they'll have the authority to be able to approve these projects because of the de minimis cost threshold. ISO customers will end up paying for these facilities, and that as a consequence of that, they will be part of the ISO balancing authority. Some of the policy drivers, obviously, the 33% renewable mandate in California is driving the schedule here and the desire to get these renewables interconnected. Also, as I just briefly alluded to, the ISO transmission model is very favorable as compared to a more traditional model. Depending on the circumstances of the generators, they may have no upfront obligation to fund transmission upgrades. They still have interconnection costs, but they may have no network upgrade cost responsibility. And then just the way the ISO market works, they don't pay ongoing wheeling charges. They just inject into the ISO system. And so that is a cost advantage. And so that helps to explain some of the incentives they have to interconnect directly to the ISO.
This is a cost advantage to them.
It is a cost advantage to them, and it's just a part of their part of the ISO's market design that they don't. If you go most places in the western United States, if they were interconnecting to an Arizona utility, they would pay transmission charges. But the way the ISO market works, and it's just a market design choice, the customers pay all the transmission in the ISO system, so not the generators. So it doesn't matter whether they're renewable or gas-fired or what have you.
Yeah. So that's the ISO's model, is the ratepayers pay for the connection, and it's the IID's model that the generators pay for those transmission fees and interconnections.
So the and we could go into enormous amounts of detail, but if there's basic like interconnection, real close to the generator, those are always borne by the generator. And then depending on whether they're needed for 33% renewables and a host of other factors, the generator could have transmission responsibilities to upfront the costs. But then, and I really want to emphasize here, going forward on a day-to-day basis, they don't pay transmission costs after the first development phase. They just inject into the system and bore you with the details. It gets to, they don't want the transmission cost to interfere with the market clearing price. And so they just want the cost of the generation to go in without factoring in the transmission costs when they create a market clearing price in the ISO's market. And so that's the economist, and I'm not an economist, I'm a lawyer, but that's the economist's rationale for how they reached that market design element in 1996-97 timeframe.
And part of that is a good explanation as to why our rates at the IID are less than those of the Cal ISO members.
I would agree. So the challenges that are facing IID as you consider these proposals Obviously, minimizing development, transmission development risks to IID customers, putting IID money at risk for generation development is obviously not to be taken lightly. There are concerns that these hybrid models might start to erode the ability of the IID to operate its core utilities operations, its balancing authority. At the same time, I think there's a desire to foster the renewable development and facilitate it for economic development purposes, and then to maintain some role in the transmission expansion of the Imperial Valley as more and more generation is proposed for development, and then obviously the geothermal potential that has been discussed for some time, if ever, becomes part of the California, you know, resource picture going forward.
Mr. Brown,
mm-hmm.
You're saying that this would encourage the transmission, the transmission generation, and the role of Imperial County. The last few words that you said, how can that be when we're being bypassed?
So if I spoke about the county's role in this, I didn't mean that in any legal sense.
I'm not speaking legally. I'm just trying to make sense out of it because we're being excluded. At least that's my understanding. I could be wrong. That we're not part of this, and yet the comment is, or your statement is, that it will increase the role?
So I look at this sort of not just with the applicability to this fairly limited proposal that's here, but also what's the next step going to be? And then what other generation in the Imperial Valley might be delivered, and how will it interconnect? The policymakers, the generators, they care about their ability to deliver to market, perform on their obligations, make money, and the policymakers obviously care about the renewable resources getting delivered and meeting the RPS mandates. Things that they care much less about are things that I would think would be important. The land use decisions, you know, where the lines are sited, you know, the types of facilities, things that are important local issues aren't things that the CalISO, for example, spends any time thinking about. If another entity were to come in and propose lines that stretch northward into the Imperial Valley to interconnect generation, how those lines get sited, how they get interconnected into the larger system, I think will be issues that that the district would have less say in if they were on the outside looking at these third-party developers, looking at these generators and their plans, as opposed to being on the forefront and perhaps even shepherding the transmission development plans going forward. So when I say having a role in it going forward, I think it is fair to say that this limited proposal is a bypass of the IID system, but it is because it's directly connecting to the ISO, but it is a facility that's going to be owned by IID. And it is a stepping stone, I think, to further examination of what the long-term transmission plans and strategic plans are for the district. And I think those are much harder issues to think through and, you know, make the difficult choices. This is obviously sort of a precursor from what might come down the road, but I think the bigger fish are yet to be before you.
So you talk of this being a type of a hybrid type of interconnection, this partial PPTO or PPTO. And by engaging in that and participating in it, the IID can somehow steer their own ship and have to control their own destiny somewhat better than drawing out a fight in this situation.
I think so, and I mean the sort of the uncomfortable message that I'm delivering is that the if the geothermal is viable, if the solar in the rest of the area is viable, I think this transmission is going to get built, and it's just a matter of how.
Okay, but as we're making a decision on this upcoming, the PPTO decision isn't ratified yet. We're voting on a solar projects that doesn't necessarily guarantee us the PPTO.
will this decision, if it moves forward, assist us in leveraging that kind of pressure to gain the PPTO on future projects?
I think it does put you in a better position. And also the thing that one of the core questions that I know I was asked to address was how it also would impact the rest of your core utility operation. Uh-huh. And there's several instances with respect to Northern California municipals that are on their own balancing authority, where and also with the agency of the federal government, Western Area Power Administration, where they have these type of hybrid arrangements with the ISO, where they share operational control of facilities, where there are rights for people inside the ISO and outside the ISO in the same facilities. So I think there's some precedent that these types of hybrid arrangements can work and not do fundamental damage to, you know, maintaining local control over how you run your
grid. So that's the forward-thinking proponents of the PPTO, allowing some kind of austerity for the IID system to be autonomous. But there's no guarantee. No, so conversely, if the PPTO is not granted, well, what position does that put the IID in on protecting its balancing authority from future projects?
So if there isn't some sort of hybrid, I think, arrangement going forward where the ISO is a driving force in what transmission gets built out, I think looking just back in the last couple cycles of the ISO's transmission plan, you can see both, you know, very, very ambitious proposals, $2 billion proposals for transmission build-outs that would increase, would essentially crisscross the valley with 500 kV high voltage transmission lines that run along the Salton Sea and also along the border. And also there was a very targeted and specific proposal by two of the generators to build a generation tie from the Imperial Valley up to the Salton Sea area. And I think those are sort of a flavor of what you're going to see going forward, where the various parties, whether they be the generators themselves or also merchant transmission developers or others, are going to keep putting these proposals on the table.
I have a question for you. How many PPTOs are there out there, and are there cost-sharing models that people have used in order to pay for them, or are all the costs borne by the Cal ISO for the project?
There's one, and so the second part is an easy answer. There's one, and it's the Western Area Power Administration, and they essentially facilitated the permitting of an upgrade of the high voltage system in the middle of the state that was subject to years and years of logjam at the California Public Utilities Commission. So they were able to use their federal authority to permit the line and facilitate construction. And but they have a significant system in the Northern California that includes high voltage transmission and hydroelectric dams. And so obviously they had a similar motivation. They didn't want to change their system, but they were under a lot of pressure to get this project done and help it get over the hurdle that it was facing. So they did that. They transferred the operational control over to the ISO. The costs of it are recovered in the ISO's rates, and they were successful in not having that arrangement affect their basic operation of the federal hydro system.
So if there are impacts to IID or any other non-Cal ISO utility, those do get paid for or reimbursed? Or how is it typical? Because that's on us where it might impact our system.
So the cost that we generally think about is the facility cost. And in this instance, it's, I think, estimated to be around $20 to $25 million. And those are the costs that the ISO customers would get rolled into their transmission rates. Any other costs as far as affected system studies are outside of the immediate issue here, which is this partial participating transmission owner and this approval of this policy-driven element that the ISO is going to consider.
But the affected system studies are the same, whether it's a PPTO or some other sort of connection.
The effect on the system and the how these renewables, what flows they will create on the system and what other upgrades might be triggered, those are an independent, obviously highly related, but those costs are what they're going to be.
And then just kind of big picture in the state of California and outside, I was wondering, with all the new generation going on, how much is located in California or out? Is there a ballpark number that, because it's trending towards more in California, isn't that right?
It is. It's. I don't have numbers for you. A lot of it is, most of it is in state. There was a considerable amount of development of wind resources, particularly in the Pacific Northwest. Mm-hmm. But since the passage of SB 2, which is the RPS law, that made it very clear that a certain percentage of it needed to be in state. I'm not being real accurate with that limitation. It's interconnected to a California or delivered to a California balancing authority. But I think, you know, for the purposes here, in-state is it accurate enough? And so going forward, the large predominance of development will be in-state. And so that does put the IID resources, the Imperial Valley resources, sort of at the top of the pecking order. The market sort of had moved away from out-of-state resources as they saw this coming because it took the legislature so long to actually pass a bill. And there were various, iterations of this in-state, out-state dichotomy. Unless there is a legal challenge that's overturned, I think the vast predominance of development going forward will be in-state.
And then what percentage, or is it the majority that's in the Cal ISO directed?
Yes.
Or directly connected to them? So no one else really has the issue that we're facing down here, do they?
There's pockets, but the bottom line is the issue you're facing is fairly unique. There's renewable resources that are connected to LA's area that's outside the ISO, but those are largely LA's resources
they're developing. Power generation.
Right. There's some exceptions to that. There are some independent generators, but it's mostly theirs. And there's the odd project, but you guys, the combining your size as a utility, the significant renewable potential and the numbers we're talking about here, the comparisons don't mean much. You guys are really dealing with this.
Yeah. And then for the generators, I assume they make more money if they're in Cal ISO because they don't have to step up and pay for the transmission, right?
I think it's favorable. I mean, I've made some generalizations, but I think it's favorable to them from an economic standpoint to be in there, and it's easier for them to get a contract with the IRUs.
So. Right. Okay, thanks.
I have one more question, but yes. I can wait till the end. Mr. Brown, you mentioned at the beginning of your presentation that this is advantageous to the developers. Are the developers from Imperial County, and how is it advantageous to them?
It's advantageous in them getting, making their project milestones and getting their project developed, and that's really what I meant by that statement. It wasn't a discussion on what advantages accrued to the Valley. And I'm probably not in a very good position to speak about, the economic development and actual hard numbers as to what kind of stimulus or other benefits they're bringing.
Okay. I don't know. Director Hanks, perhaps you know more than I do, but I don't know how this can be advantageous to Imperial County or the working families, but please let me know if I'm missing something here.
Let me
jobs.
Put my opposing view in here. Okay. Short term, there's a lot of jobs, construction jobs, and Lord knows that we need jobs. Long term, I don't see it as cooperation, where it's going to be an advantage. I see it as feeding the alligator before he eats you. The IOU and Cal ISOs are all pushing for a single state balancing authority. So we've got that battle, and can we win that? I don't know. But you have to understand the business model between the IOUs and Cal ISO and public utilities. And the IOUs, their bottom line, their business model is to turn a profit for their stockholders. And to continue to do that, there has to be growth. They have to continue to reach out. And for some public utilities, we talk about our rates and so forth. The reason our rates are where they're at is because we're an irrigation district. First, we're not returning a dividend to stockholders, okay? Second, we're also not paying or supplanting cities for their revenues, LADWP and so forth, a public utility, but the city council just continually takes revenue from them. You know, from that standpoint, then we should take advantage of being an irrigation district, and we should have about as low as rates as you can get in California, which is pretty close to where we're at. But how do we continue that? How do we continue to protect our ratepayers? We have compliance issues on transmission and so forth. We're expected to maintain the same levels as the investor owns, where they're allowed to continue up their rates and pass that burden on to the ratepayers. And about the only way we can compete that way is to, through these projects, okay, use the wheeling rates and so forth to upgrade our system without having to pass it on to our ratepayers, because this is basically exporting. You know, it's not power they're using. So it comes back to the economic development. Okay, so you have solar, which has that short term, and there's some additional jobs there, but when it moves in onto your ag ground, that displaces some. Then you have geothermal. Geothermal is the Cadillac for economic development. That's where the jobs are at, 24/7. The wheeling connects to the IID if we continue to protect it. If we don't protect it and we continue into these hybrid situations to be able to compete and sell their energy, they're going to have to connect into these hybrid systems. We're going to lose that wheeling. Now we have stranded investments. So how do we continue to pay for our transmission long term? So that's what I'm worried. And in fairness, on you know what we're doing, we're probably protecting our balance and authority to a degree for now. Whether we can stop expansion and continue the encroachment into us, I don't know. But the part that you're missing, Mr. Braun, we're irrigation district, what happens to our displaced water? I didn't hear you mention water one time in your presentation. And that displaced water is our lifeblood. And you know what? Right now we have overruns. We could... If push comes to shove and the state doesn't recognize it as conserved water, you know, in our plans where we're going. Right now, the farming economy is good. They're using a lot of water. We have overruns. We might push it there. But when we have downward turns, that water is going to become unused. It's going to leave here for zero. So now we've taken a double hit because you know, we displaced the farm grounds, and people that farm here know that you just about have to keep that ground active to keep it alive. So from that standpoint, it's a tough business. I can't sit here and say that the decisions we're making out there are wrong, because I think right now we're just, you know, we've got an offensive guy on top of us and we're just playing defense. Should have, you know, long time ago, we should have had our lines in place. We had 2007, after the Prudence Review, we had strategic plans and build out. Probably would have protected this, but it never got built. So it comes down to, you know, you have thousands of short-term opportunities of jobs there. But when that's over with, what as a director, okay, what is my responsibility? So you have the economic development, you have the protection of the IID system, you take oaths. You know, it comes down to a real tough decision making. In the long run, the IOUs will probably eat us up until they get to a point to where they have no more public agencies to take over. And then you get a pushback from their ratepayers because this continued growth and the expense that they're facing. And I keep thinking somewhere down the line you see that come out of San Diego where they start pushing back and start trying to form a public utility. But the problem here for me is affordability of our local people. And without good jobs, that affordability may not come. Likewise, if we end up in CalISO or we lose our balance and authority, again, it may be a double whammy. So, you know, I'm just trying to look out both pictures, try to weigh this thing out. Where do you go? Where do you vote? And at the end of the day, I don't want to commit to a bunch of transmission build-out at the expense of the ratepayers if the inevitable is going to happen and we're going to get ran over.
So, Director Hanks, if I may, Mr. Braun didn't touch on the water aspect, which I agree is fundamental to our mission as an irrigation district. All of these projects that we're talking about that bypass us in the Mount Signal area, with the PPTO or without the PPTO, we do have a policy and we do have a contract that we'll be presenting to you so that IID can bank that saved water. So that any of that freed up conservation goes toward satisfying our obligations under the QSA with the Coachella transfer, in our own environmental purposes, of which we have many, and some sort of peg that is future-looking in case the existing transfer were to go away and were replaced by something else. That document will be coming to you. It is already district policy. The contract itself is going to undergo some advice and consent with your board.
With the loss of the revenue on the wheeling, the only saving grace is if we protect that water and we get the plan that you're talking about, that agreement in place. That's the only saving grace for us as an irrigation district, because it will offset some of the expense red figures of conserving water, particularly in the case of the Coachella Valley agreement, where the amount that they're paying for the water is piddly.
So the economics of the transfer that have been so contested, we would get some relief there by being able to claim this water. But beyond that, there will have to be a mix of transmission on IID's part, if only to limit the incursion that Mr. Braun's talking about, particularly from Ivy Sub to the Salton Sea resource area.
And it is my understanding that we do have one project that just has one hurdle to clear to connect to us, to the IID system. Is that correct?
There is the one 150 megawatt project that you know about. My understanding is that there are a couple that are in final sort of delicate stages of a PPA.
Yeah. But Director Hanks, also we have the recent CPUC finding of RA for 1,400 megawatts and IID's BA. That should make the developers on our system more competitive when they sell into the ISO market.
Mr. Kelly, just drawing on institutional memory, there was a mechanism to make the water from projects such as this, if we have in place and we make them part of a extraordinary effort, and I think then it is considered conserved water on our part, and then we get to keep it. Boy, I'm going to suggest are you familiar with what I'm talking about? Do you remember that verbiage?
Intentionally created surplus water.
And then it's treated as conserved water for our purposes. And we need to take a look at that, and if that program needs to be implemented, then we could well do it and make our participation in these projects part of that program.
That something very much like that is what we're talking
okay,
about.
Okay, but I'm saying there is verbiage that says that, and I believe it's in the water code.
So I'll be most interested in your review of this document.
I'm going to ask you to do one favor. Someone needs to check with John Carter, because I know he's going to he would know where it is. I think it's in the water code, but I've read it and I've seen it. It's just been a long time, people, but it's there.
Yeah, let me add a couple other points here. Not so much the solar on these issues, but geothermal especially. And we brought it up with a new board. I want to keep it out fresh, keep it pushing, and keep our lobbyists working on it. Because I know the geothermal people are working on it. And that's institutional load or station load. Give you an example, the plan up by Raleigh, they're generating about 27 megawatts on the market, but there's like 14 megawatt institutional load that they're using, that they're generating for their own use. We provide the water for it, okay? And a lot of situations out there along the sea, we provide the resource, okay? And that would go a long ways into helping this area. If the state wants us to participate in these hybrids, they need to reciprocate. They need to give us that credit for those. And additionally, we're looking at ways to conserve our water. And one of the obstacles that we're faced with is a pump back system and the use of energy. If we're using energy to provide water, to create water for the urban dwellers, there should be some type of renewable credit for the use of that energy also. And, you know, it seems like we're sitting here, the resources are here, and we've got them coming at us on the power side, we've got them coming on the water side. It's about time that the state recognizes, okay, that there's got to be an equitable exchange for us just rolling over for these people.
So, Director Hanks, this reciprocity argument that you've made repeatedly, as the old board wrestled with this same issue, I did have a conversation with Mr. Picker, the governor's advisor on renewable projects, last week, on not only the institutional load that you're talking about, but especially the water to be saved from solar conversion. And he advised me that we should work through our electeds. I've spoken with Mr. Ortega about that. We believe this is a ripe issue for our assemblyman. And I believe we can count on the governor's help should we run into a problem with the junior right holder.
Yeah, you know, just in the budget workshop, we were looking at the increase in our power bills associated with renewable energy. To me, it's a little hard for me to understand that we have 1,300 megawatts of power being generated and going to be more, bypassing us. Okay, we're giving right-of-ways and working with these hybrid systems. But yet, our ratepayers we're going to up their rates. And we're also looking at capital. How are we going to provide capital to upgrade our system? Just doesn't gel right with me. You know, how do we make this work for us? And it can work. It can work for everybody. But they're going to have to see us as a partner. Meet us halfway. Thank you.
Yeah. Mr. Braun, were you aware of our efforts on parasitic loss or our station load that we've been working on?
Generally, I know it's been an issue that's been discussed in the industry, in other states where they have a concentration of geothermal. There was discussion at the Regis Forum about how to maybe potentially change the definition. I know also some of their neighboring states have been tackling it. And I would add that the California Energy Commission that writes the eligibility rules for renewables is undergoing multiple revisions of what they call their eligibility guidebook. So that might be something that might be tackled to see if there's a way that might get some relief on that.
I also believe that Nevada just passed that parasitic load issue in the state of Nevada. So it's something that there is precedent now on that issue and something we should be pursuing.
Okay, we have a big agenda here. Let's get back to the subject here. Any other discussion on this item? Mr. Braun, any closing words?
Thank you.
I appreciate you coming down. And
thank you.
Hopefully we added to your workload a little bit, huh?
Know that some of your municipal brethren are also wrestling with the impact on their ratepayers and how to deal with the different business model than in some of the larger areas of the state. So.
Like in the public, do you have any comment on this subject? Okay, thank you, Mr. Braun.
You.
Let's move on to the next item. It's a Water Department General Matters. Mr. Silva?
Good evening, Mr. President, board members. All I have is just an update on our overrun that we've been talking about. We're at almost 157,000 acre feet as of today. Hoping to have a little bit of rain the end of the week to maybe help us there, but that's where we are right now. Oh, just another quick item. If you remember, we put out some advertising regarding our customers to give us some indication of what kind of conservation they would like to do on farm. That closed on December 5th. It was last week. We did get quite a few calls at the end of that, towards the end of that week. We'll try to summarize that and get back to you in a couple of weeks on what we have and where we are on that. Any other questions? That's all I've got.
Any questions for Mr. Silva?
Jesse, you talked about doing makeup water next year for our overrun a year or two ago, mm-hmm. and then the fallowing program looking forward. I was just wondering if we can get a status update on looking forward to fallowing acres, what we anticipate it's going to need to be fallowed. I know
we want to do an update to the board at the beginning of the year and talk about all those numbers and bring everybody up to date because it is getting to be quite a bit. So
yeah, and I have farmers calling me looking for ground. We're looking for ground. It's a fight out there. So
yeah, and so we want to do that at the beginning of the year, get us all cut up on where we're at because it is a big issue now, and what we're going to do about it, because going forward we need to look at things a little differently as if we're going to get that far behind on our overrun.
Yeah, I think another thing we need to consider too is this valley has a huge export market, not only in wheat but seed crops, alfalfa, sedan, things like that, and a lot of those are affected. Are negatively impacted by the fallowing program, so there's just less inventory out there. A lot of the exporters are losing business and fewer trucks going to the port. So there's an affected industry that's probably not in the queue that people know about. But it is something that hopefully we can solve with on-farm conservation. And I look to spearhead that with the WCAB's help. And when is the next meeting for WCAB?
They're meeting this Thursday.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me. Thank you.
Comments from the public?
Kevin left. At the WCAB, will the level of Lake Mead be discussed and the effect on the overrun?
We don't have that scheduled, Director Hanks, but we need to talk about it as soon as possible, yeah. And so it probably won't be till the next meeting, but because, till the end of the year, we might have something happen that where at least it gets close to it or something, so we still have a little bit of time. So we have not scheduled that, no.
All right, thank you.
Okay, moving on to item 12, a review of executive summary pertaining to an independent analysis of groundwater storage and recovery potential at the East Mesa region.
Good afternoon, Mr. President, directors. Brief history before I introduce our guest. About a year and a half ago, there was great interest in groundwater storage. And whenever we discussed that, it was always a question of where and how much. And the question of East Mesa always came up at the time. There was also a lot of reports floating around out there. There was a lot of interpretation of those reports. With discussion with the management above me, we felt it would be important to try to get the best handle we could on what those reports were saying. Some of them agreed with each other, some of them disagreed. So we put together an RFP that completed an analysis of all those reports in various locations out on East Mesa, and then kind of brought together a unified hydrogeological summary of the potential for those sites out there to be viable for recharge and storage. They were not to mine any new data. They were not paid to generate anything new. They all had to pull it from what was available. And so we received that final report here just this month. And so tonight we have a presentation of that analysis. So with that, I would like to introduce Mr. Brian Villalobos and Mr. Dennis Williams from Geoscience who did the analysis of that, and they'll be given the presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Vince, Mr. President, Chairman, and members of the board. I'm Dennis Williams, President of Geoscience. I'll be making the presentation along with one of my senior geohydrologists, Brian Villalobos. But essentially, like Vince says, over the last 30 years, there's been a number of investigations regarding potential for artificial recharge or groundwater storage or banking in various areas. And our task was to look at all the information that was available and then come up with a kind of an understanding or ranking of these potential recharge sites. So we went through and looked at everything that was available, looked at the geology, hydrology, and here you can see the location of Salton and Sea up here. But we were tasked with looking at these three areas, the East Mesa, the Amos, and the Pilot Knob area. And these three areas were the focus that we were given. And I'd like to have Mr. Brian Villalobos, one of our senior geohydrologists who was the project manager on this, who's going to go through in the next few minutes some of the analysis that we did on these three areas, the potential for artificial recharge or banking, and the recovery. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Brian.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Williams. Let me go to the next slide here. So our scope of work essentially was to go out and take a look at the sites, but really what we were supposed to, what we really dug into was to look at all of the in-house groundwater files that IID has, also look at what studies and reports have been done, and also do a little bit of research in terms of what professional academic papers were available. We took that data, reviewed it, synthesized it, and then we prepared the report that I'll show you in just a second. and then made recommendations on based on what we found out for those particular areas. So the three sites, as Dr. Williams said, were Amos Valley, which is up, obviously, as you know, up in the north end of the sand dune area, Pilot Knob, and then the entire East Mesa. So what we found, we looked at over 50 reports. We compiled a database ranging from around 1917 to the current time for water quality, water levels. We pulled together all of the drillers' logs, groundwater, different lithologic logs, geologic interpretations and cross-sections. Put them all together to see what do we have in hand to be able to evaluate with the existing data these particular sites. And we found that Amos Valley and Pilot Knob, there really is insufficient data to evaluate those particular areas in terms of doing groundwater recharge. There's insufficient subsurface data, there's insufficient water level data, there's insufficient water quality data for those areas. In addition to that, there are some issues with the existing fault systems that run out there, as well as potential capacity, and I'll go over that in just a minute. Also, for Pilot Knob area, the Colorado River accounting surface lies underneath that entire area, and at this point, we don't know what the water rights issues would be in terms of storing water above that, how we would account for it, and how that would go. So that's another issue. Specifically for Amos Valley, we don't know if there's sufficient aquifer storage capacity. In other words, if you were to build a recharge facility up on the alluvial fans below those mountain ranges, is there enough area thickness vertically to store the amount of water that you might want to put there? We don't know that. Also, as the water, the blue arrows here. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me push. So the blue arrows here are essentially what the groundwater flow direction. It moves down the alluvial fan and then across towards the Salton Sea. And we don't know where your extraction system would be. Would it have to be in the sand dunes? Would there be environmental issues associated with that? How these two faults, the Algodones Fault and the San Andreas Fault, how that would affect groundwater flow? Would it act to mound it and we start to lose it at the surface? Would it flow across it? And then the other issue here that we don't know is mixing with poor quality water as you come to the valley floor. We know that there's poor quality water immediately below the valley floor, what the mixing would be. So these are areas that we don't have the data to then evaluate Amos Valley. Pilot Knob, again, just quickly, the green lines that are here, where did my red dot go? See if I lost it. Here we go. The green lines that are shown here are the Colorado River accounting surface. If we were to put a recharge project anywhere in here, it would lie above the accounting surface. So all water, groundwater that's above the accounting surface is not part of the Colorado River allotment in terms of the river. So that would be, if the water is stored on top of that, we would have to account for how much is there. And again, as I said earlier, what the water rights issues would be that are unknown at this point. Again, we have the similar condition here along these faults. How would they act in terms of either impeding water flow? Would they help us in terms of containing it? Or would they act to cause us to lose it at the surface? So that's what's unknown in these areas. And then lastly, the East Mesa area. Of all of the numerous reports that we looked at, essentially there were two reports that address the geologic and hydrogeologic conditions for storing water in the East Mesa area. Leroy Crandall and Associates in 83 did a report, but theirs was directed or focused at recovering seepage losses that were there over the years from the unlined canal. But in doing that, they generated a considerable amount of data, subsurface geologic and hydrogeologic data in this area, and they were able to quantify, they were able to characterize this area fairly significantly, which provides us kind of in a different way of looking at it. Now that the canal has been lined, the seepage losses have been reduced, there's now storage space there as a result. So that report, and the other one was the Bureau of Recs report that was done in 88, 1889. They actually did a pilot test up in this region of the in the old Coachella Canal. They did a pilot test where they put water in the old canal, and then they had created monitoring wells, so they were able to track the moving water as they recharged it in the old canal. That report has considerable data in terms of the subsurface data, the water quality. They did a good job in that report, and their summary was that it's feasible in this particular area. So based on these two reports, you currently have enough data to be able to develop the type of groundwater model that would be able to test various sites in this area here, and they're close to both canals to either for extraction purposes. The only consideration for the East Mesa is the water quality. Now, over the years, when water was discharged through the old Coachella Canal, that water, Colorado River water, infiltrated the ground surface and created areas. Now, the green dots are dots that represent water quality that is less than 1,000 milligrams per liter. The yellow dots are groundwater with water quality that's greater than 1,000 milligrams per liter. Some of these go up to 7 or 8,000 milligrams per liter, the yellow dots. You should have this map in front of you, and you can see what the data is. So you kind of see green dots along the All-American Canal. You can see green dots along the old Coachella Canal. And then it's kind of interspersed, like polka-dotted. And what that is that over the years, the better quality water is migrated in the subsurface and mixed with the native quality water, which is higher in TDS. So what this says is that what needs to be done specifically here is to reprofile the groundwater quality in the East Mesa. There are existing monitoring wells that have been in place for many years to understand exactly what areas are good quality water, what areas are poor quality water, and where a project would affect those, what impact the project would have on the water quality in this area. Okay, so essentially we were tasked also to see what was said in the past, what have previous investigators said about the area, what agreements that they have, what disagreements that they had. And essentially, the only disagreements that we have come to recognize from the reporting is the vertical stratification of the aquifers in the East Mesa. We have the Crandall report divided the aquifer systems into two zones, an upper and a lower. And Bureau of Rec did the same thing, but if you look at this chart, you can see the Bureau of Rec's upper aquifer was a little thicker. It was almost twice as thick as the Crandall, but that can easily be the reason for that could be that the USBR study was further to the north, whereas the Crandall report was further to the south. And geologically, this could happen, where you have the geologic layers can change in thickness depending on where they're at in the area. We know the whole East Mesa is the product of the Colorado River Delta as it's shifted its course, in ancient times and in prehistoric times. And so this could easily be that reason. So there may not be a discrepancy with that, just could be a matter of location. But there was a considerable amount of agreement. And some of the agreement was both reports recommended that there's additional data collected on the geology. Both reports agreed that the upper aquifer has better quality than the lower part of the lower aquifer. The chemical character, these things were all both reports agreed upon. And then also, both reports agreed that a prudent thing to do would be to build a groundwater model that would allow you to test what the recharge facilities, what impacts they would have with time. And also, again, there's the need to resample and analyze the water quality again, and then also to test wells, and just your kind of a standard protocol for evaluating specific sites. And then again, a Crandall report, and this is, I think, an important feature, is they estimated that there was 750,000 acre-feet of recoverable water at that time in the East Mesa. And 225,000 acre feet were present in zones southeast, in the southeast portion of East Mesa. So the point of that is that at that time, this recoverable water was there, but now that becomes a place where there's a place to store water, because the water levels have decreased as seepage has been inhibited or halted. So that becomes an area that the water has been flushed through there, and it becomes a potential place to store water. Let me just move on. So we're also asked to look at what would you do if you wanted to pursue a recharge project in these sites. And this is kind of a summary. Obviously, our report has more detailed descriptions of these ideas. But again, for Amos Valley and Pilot Knob, there's a considerable amount of data that needs to be collected to even say this is good or bad. So you can see where the X's are. That says each one of these sort of items has to be looked at to be able to make that evaluation. You see less X's here on the components for the USBR study, simply because they've done a pilot test already. They've gone through and they've already tested it in terms of recharge, where the water goes once you put it in the ground, how could you collect it once it's in the ground. So they've done a considerable amount of work, but again, it's further to the north and a little bit less accessible in terms of extracting in time. And the East Mesa requires additional data, but there's sufficient data to design a model now to be able to begin to evaluate some potential facilities. And then lastly of all, we created a site ranking, site criterion ranking, and essentially we went over, is there aquifer parameter? In other words, do we understand the hydraulics of the underground system? What would be some of the potential infiltration rates? Can we get water in the ground fast enough? Is there available land area? Is there adequate aquifer storage? Is there enough underground storage to keep the amount of water that we may want to store with time? Capacity for groundwater extraction. Are the materials in such that we can put it in and take it out when we need it? Can we extract it in an efficient manner? Also, what's the groundwater quality? Is it appropriate for this sort of an operation? Are there vertical barriers? Are there clay layers in the ground that once you put water in, it would stop the water from further going down? Are there horizontal barriers? Once you put the water in the ground, it begins to move with gravity down gradient. Are there barriers that would stop it from and cause it to mound in that area? Also, is there ability to contain the recharge volumes? What's the proximity to the All-American Canal for extraction and putting it back in, or to the Coachella Canal? Obviously, is there data available for conceptual design? Do we have the type of data that you need to begin to design the a recharge facility? Potential impact on the Colorado River Accounting Service, and then environmental considerations. And the chart is there. We weighed them based on the data that we found in our research, and the lower number is less less desirable, and the higher number indicates the highest ranking in terms of potential recharge, and these where we can. So the East Mesa and the southeast portion, we feel has the best potential for developing a recharge facility, and that'll do it. So are there any questions?
On the Amos Valley.
Yes, sir.
In proximity to Glamis, where is that?
Okay, so the Amos Valley section is here, where I'm kind of moving this
north and brown
up in there, just at the very northern end of the sand dunes.
Northern end.
Well, it's on the west side of the dunes.
Yeah, Glamis is to the right. Is that what you're saying?
Glamis is here.
Did you look at any records from the railroad?
We contacted them to see if there was any information, and we weren't able to get data from them. There, when we were out there, we noticed there was a well being drilled for the railroad, and we tried to pursue that, but we didn't get too far in the
to collect the
drilling logs.
Yeah, we used swimming there, yeah. Fish. Yeah.
We actually ran into the railroad personnel that handled that, and he tried to even get us information, and he didn't have anything that would. We were trying to get information from that big wellhead right there at Amos, where the big building is, and we were not able to track that down.
Did the wellhead still working, or are they drilling a new one?
Yeah.
That water
actually comes from the Coachella Canal all the way to those trees. They don't use any facilities right there.
So it's not well.
Pumped from the Coachella.
Yeah.
The water at Regina is...
Oh, the trees.
The trees. Almost couldn't be.
It is. They pump it all the way from the Coachella Canal because I had to go back out there because they wanted to expand their capability. So they have a pumping station off the Coachella, and they pump up to the railroad and then along over Mammoth Wash and then all the way to the trees, and that's how they irrigate all those trees, is pumping from the Coachella.
Was a small diameter well that they just drilled that they were using a little bit further to the south, and we got phone numbers. I tried to call them to see if we could get information on how much it pumped, get their drillers' logs, but we didn't.
Track that information?
The state does track it, but by the time they fill out their drillers' report and get it to the state, it was already past our time frame.
Don't they
to
have
this.
To get permits from the county to sink a well?
We went to the county. We went to the Environmental Services. We made a lot of phone calls, talked to a lot of people, but didn't get any additional data for those.
There was one small pump, and it was for the construction of the new culverts. So it was just mitigating, it was dust water. So it wasn't a very big pump that they had set up. But we did.
So who owns that water up there in the East Mesa? The groundwater.
As far as I understand, I mean, whoever owns the land up there would own the water beneath the land in those areas.
I know Coachella, if you sink a well, you pay the water district. You don't own the water under your ground. So I've talked to farmers that have wells that use it for different purposes, and they have to pay for it.
That's correct, Mr. Benson.
Good question.
Yeah, I think Imperial County, you're right, the service...
Okay, any other comments from the board or from the public?
Did you look at any of the tests where they check the age of the water?
Yes.
Some of the water predated, some old documents I saw predated the Coachella Canal.
Right, that's true. That's true. The USGS has dated some of the water, and so some of it predates, and that's native groundwater. Again, our concern was to look at information that would say, is this a good site to put water in and take it back out again? The water that's put in is your water being stored, and then the water being taken out is the water that you've put into the system. So we did find some well logs up in here. There is some information, but it's not enough to be able to really evaluate.
Just this gentleman that went to stand, did you talk with him?
No, this gentleman?
Yeah, you should talk to him and the one next to him. He could tell you all about the water.
Were you given the Lawrence Livermore report?
Yes.
So your study is also based
on? Right, we've included the Lawrence Livermore. Yes, we did. Yeah.
And there's no references here to any of that?
No, the Kleinfelder report specifically deals with this. The Lawrence Livermore report is a regional. It's a regional study. So the two reports that I listed, the USBR and the Crandall report, are more specific and they're more detailed for the hydrogeology in this area.
The very latest is the Kleinfelder, and I ran the wells for that.
Right. So that was the I think I'm putting my arrow right on there, the red line. And we looked at the data that was generated there as a potential source of aquifer information specifically in this area.
I have a couple questions. One is, generally speaking, what would be the cost to get water there? Did you look at any of that?
We didn't look at the economics of that, no.
Okay, because we're looking at putting it in and then recharging the basin, but then we have to pull it out using power, right? So there is a cost to doing that.
Right, as well
then,
as, yeah.
And intentionally created storage, is that a beneficial use? So we could put excess water there, or are we using our current supply to put it in?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it would be.
Okay.
If I may,
institutional knowledge can be dangerous, I guess. I don't know. The Board of Supervisors, not this current one, gosh, this was like Bill Cole and Sam Sharp and the other. They kept touting the fact that there was an 800,000 acre foot reservoir over there. And we were talking about putting in wellheads to recover seepage on the All-American Canal. And they just raised hell with us over that issue. And somehow they were quoting the figure of around 800,000. How did they come about that? I mean, somebody in the county had to either know. I mean, I can't imagine they were trying to guess at something like that.
Director Kuhn, it was actually 1.6 million.
Why is 800,000 coming to mind?
Because it was two tranches of water.
Okay, but they shoved that down our throats over and over and over. We weren't going to touch that. It was their water, and they were going to control it.
Matter of fact, I'm sure Mr. Silver remembers there was talk of using some of that for salt and sea mitigation.
Exactly. Now, where did they come by that number?
I think Brian was going to refer to that.
Well, I was just looking at this chart here. When this feasibility study of recovering the seepage was done by the Crandall's group, they calculated 750,000 acre feet, and simply they just looked at the storage capacity of the aquifers under its current saturated conditions, and they came up with this number. So they looked at they built cross sections across to East Mesa, looked at the water levels, and said, okay, you've got so much thickness of saturated sands and gravels, it's got so much porosity, so it's a certain volume of water, and that was what was in their report.
Who did the report?
It was Leroy Crandall Associates was done for the six agencies committee.
And you're saying that this is the report that the county was relying on?
That part I can't speak to. Oh, I can only speak to what I reviewed in this report.
I throw it out for what it's worth. That's the number they were throwing out.
I have a question. When you pull out groundwater like that and it has a high TDS rating and then you recharge it with cleaner water, does it clean up your groundwater?
Well, you can see by the data in this one. Let me just go back to this right here, this map. You know, there is a flushing that takes place. And in the areas where the former seepage, where Colorado water was seeping, you can see that the water quality is still fairly similar to what the water was when it was recharged. So as the water moved, water that was seeping in the All-American Canal both moved northward to the Salton Sea, and also some of it down in here moved southward to Mexico. But all of this area moved northward to the Salton Sea. And you can see some of these green dots in here. That's not native water. That would have been indicative that there was a seepage water moving through those layers.
Is that the same rating as the water in the canal, or is it saltier than the water in the canal?
It's slightly saltier.
But not
terribly salty. And that's why we used 1,000 milligrams as a kind of an arbitrary cutoff, because we wanted to see water that was 600, 500, 700, that in that range, which is closer to the to
what
the
is water. Canal water?
I think it's around 620. Can you help me on it? 700, okay. So,
and is that increasing over time? I know there's a salt study on the Colorado River, right?
It's going down, actually.
Really?
I can tell you people that on the south side of the international boundary, there are some really nice farms back there, and the produce farms. I mean, we're not talking, alfalfa and stuff. They got that really good water coming out of there. You can drink it out of the ground when it comes out of the ground. I've been there. Been there a lot of times. And it's a high producing vegetable area. Yeah.
Rod Williams. I've waited 2 years to hear this report. I'm glad you did it. But I think that you need to really, these fellows need to focus on the latest study that was done by Lawrence Livermore states that the Imperial County, it says the Salton Sea area is the largest untapped aquifer in the continental United States. It's a huge industry in itself. And as I received some information from San Diego Water Authority a couple of weeks ago on their Poseidon adventure, I call it, and they're looking at spending billions of dollars and borrowing water from the sea at 50,000 or 35,000 TDS. And we have water here in Imperial County, underground water, a lot of it, huge volumes, that's less than 2,000 TDS. So even the cost of RO water will be substantially less here than it is on the coast. It's a complete industry. It'll become one of the largest things. We may never see it in my lifetime. But on the southeast corner of the East Mesa, when I took the ground over from Mr. Brock, I bought a $1,000 monitor to drop in the well. Some of you have been there. The water level was 72 feet to static water. We took water samples. We've spent thousands and thousands of dollars monitoring water. It's good drinking water. It's 88 degrees constant temperature. It'll grow the best crops you want to put out there. Since that time, after the earthquake straight south of that farm, some of the land in Mexico, the water emulsified the land. They lost it. We now know, after a $75,000 study with Kleinfelder Company that was done 2 or 3 years ago, we put transducers in the three wells. We monitor it for 2 weeks, a long time, buzz back and forth. The water level, the static water is 47 feet. The water table in the East Mesa is rising. I pump 22 to 2400 gallons a minute with a 10-inch pump with 11 feet of drawdown. Unbelievable. That water should be drawing down 50, 60 feet at minimum. There's pressurized water under there. We sent tests to the University of Florida. It's all been, I can't think today, but they did their tests on it to check where it came from and what the history was. It's all in a very extensive, very professionally done report. You're wasting tons of money on this project, and we have had some of the past directors, and I know Mr. Hanks has been there, Director Hanks, and I think Norma even went out one time. And, you know, some of the other past directors. If you want a recharge system, the man that headed up the Imperial Valley Regional Water Planning deal was stood in the middle of the field. I started the pumps. He watched the thing. He stood there. He turns around. He looks everywhere. He says, well, this is the perfect place. Mr. Hanks was standing there. 2 weeks later, 3 weeks later, time goes on. The report comes out. There was politics involved. He stood there. He said, you can, the way the configuration of the ground, it's a mile and a half to the Coachella Canal and 3 miles to the All-American. He said, all we got to do here is lay a mile and a half of pipeline, and we can do a pilot project. The wells are already here. We got engines on them to pump. Mr. Brock was very kind to participate. Would have been very interested in helping the district. He specifically gave me instructions. We don't want to go anywhere outside of Imperial Valley. We want to work with the IID. I had people from Metropolitan that flew in. They wanted to buy the place. Okay? You know, sometimes a good civil servant and people that live in their own hometown are not appreciated. And there's a man that is. That's all I have to say.
going to be a hard act to follow, Cowboy.
I'm just going to say I was hesitant to hand out the report until I was able to present it to the board. It is available. It's about, paper-wise, it's about 4 inches thick. I have it on CD that I can make available to anybody that would like it. So that is available.
Somebody ought to ask him what crops he's grown out there without water.
I'll ask.
We've grown peanuts. We've grown wheat. Mr. Brock for years grew asparagus. It'll grow anything you want to put on it.
Is this the old Brock experimental station you're talking about?
No, it's the section that, that Jim owns on it's north. Behind
it. Okay.
3 miles northwest. I've
been there.
Diagrams drawn up. I've given it to different board members. I've worked for 3 or 4 years diligently, and it's a golden opportunity for this organization. And if you look at that storage, and then you get into water. The water conservation program that you need for the district currently, there's a multitude of things that we can do.
That's all he was going
to
say.
But with the new board, we need to move forward and do it aggressively.
I personally want to thank you for taking your time coming down there. I think everybody here needed to hear that.
Thank you, Rod.
I want one other thing I have to say. In the north end of the Imperial Valley, I stood on a drilling rig about a year ago, and it's a very interesting thing that we have here. You know, I cleared some ground for the IID. I'm trying to help as much as I can. But the water conservation efforts that are in the QSA can be attained in 2 years. The 130,000 acre feet can be saved in 2 years. The balance of this organization can, once you see that way it can be done, there is water available under the valley here, but we stood on a drilling rig that they were doing some test wells. We need to spend some money to do more test wells. I've met with Mr. Kelly. And it needs to have a program in place to do some testing on underground, because you have a clay lens at 200 to 250 feet. And when you take a test rig and you eliminate that with the TDS monitor, you go below that, you've got clear water, very good water, from 250 to 900 feet deep. You seal the top of the 250 feet off. I've drilled wells all over the central part of the United States since I was 17 years old. I started learning about water on a drilling rig, pulling pumps. I've drilled water wells in Kansas, Nebraska, Oklahoma, Colorado, Wyoming, and developed a lot of ground. And I'm telling you, you're sitting on a gold mine. It's a complete industry in itself. You may see the day when the farms here use groundwater and you have all of the water that you have to sell to the coast.
Oh.
or Metropolitan will slant drill.
I'm sorry, I might have gone a little too far, but I'm telling you, it's a very, very interesting option.
I have one comment, and it's just based on the report. Maybe you can answer this, but the USBR study shows the second aquifer zone has a higher TDS than the upper aquifer.
That's true. Both the Crandall report in the south and the USBR in the north mentioned that the upper aquifer had lower TDS water. Okay. The upper aquifer had lower TDS than the lower.
Okay.
Mr. Kelly, the pilot project you've been considering will pretty much verify what you've heard here.
That's my hope.
Okay, any other comments or questions? Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Williams. Our next item up for information is review request for proposals for local entity competitive program 2012.
That's me again. In your board packets for tonight, there is a an RFP for the 2012 competitive program. It is, for the most part, exactly the same as the 2010. There are some very brief, small changes. And to present that very briefly, I have Gustavo here. He'll go over those very quickly. And then it'll come back for approval for at the next board meeting.
Good evening, Mr. President, members of the board.
Welcome, Gustavo.
Thank you very much. You have before you a summary of the competitive mitigation program for 2012. We provide this to you so that you can have a little bit of background of the program and how the basic guidelines of that program. The basic changes that we have here is one. First of all, we have established that those entities that have received funds in 2008 and 2010 are no longer eligible under the 2012 program. This was done for the purpose of providing more entities the possibility of obtaining grant funds under this program. We've also clarified some issues, such as defining that a qualified employment is 32 hours of work per week. We've also required mandatory use of the matrix form. Even though the matrix form was utilized in the last program, it was done on a voluntary basis. It was very useful, and now we are requiring them to use this mandatory use of the form. We've also adjusted some of the points that were awarded. It's still a 100-point system. But we found that the use of matrix basically would require us to lower the point total for evaluation in the program because it's already included within that matrix program. So we readjusted it to provide 6 points for definition of the economic impacts that are being obtained through the services of the program. Those are the basic changes of the program. We've also gone in and detailed a little bit more of the program, clarified a few more issues. But as Vince said, it is basically the same program.
And any other groups or advisory committees or boards that review or see this documentation, Gustavo?
No, as of this moment, no. It is just being brought to you for your knowledge and future action.
So in the past, Mr. Kelly, we reviewed this document ourselves and taken action to adopt it, or do we send it out to other agencies or committees?
I don't know that there's ever been that kind of peer review. I think it's the IID board reviews it, and then when you're ready, we bring it back to you for action.
In both programs of 2008 and 2010, it was brought directly to the board.
Mr. President?
Yes, Mr. Kidd.
I don't know whether this is the appropriate time. I believe it is, since we're talking about this thing. Is there any chance that you could get on the agenda for perhaps next meeting the organizational structure of that thing? Because I believe it to be way too damn political for this board to be doing that. I think it needs to go back to something like, it doesn't have to be big, you know, but I mean it, something like it was in the original without directors sitting on it. Because trust me, it was used as a political hammer, and it should not ever have been used as a political hammer.
So you're talking about the organizational structure of the local entity?
Yes, sir.
And rather than the board being the participant as the local entity, having a committee set up as the local entity?
As pretty much like it was, because it was substantially less political. And when it was handed over here, I'm telling you, I got clobbered with it, and there was no need for it.
Okay, we can put that on for discussion, Mr. Kuhn, in the future. In the meantime, this item is presented to us for information, so board members should be reviewing it and contacting those individuals that participate in it for their feedback for some kind of future decision by this board, one way or the other.
Fine.
Yeah, Mr. Reyes.
Eric Reyes. Here's the executive director of the Institute for Social Economic Justice, which has received funding in the first two cycles in 08 and when was it, 08 and 010 and 2010, as well as three other organizations, Arbor, who has a representative here, Neighborhood House, who has a representative here, and public authority, Norma Saquon's agency as well, who's not here, but also they have received funding. So basically you're eliminating four organizations for doing very well when everyone had the same opportunity to apply. It's a competitive process. In your non-competitive process, are you not allowing people to not receive funds if they receive in the first two cycles? My question? So in the non-competitive cycle, you're allowing them to receive funds again, and you will again and again. That's how it was established. I think this competitive fund was also established to get the best program out there, not the one that you've been funded twice. Therefore, you were too successful. Therefore, you can't apply again. I don't know if my organization will apply. I'm sure I know Neighborhood House would love to, Ann Arbor and so on. The thing is, I sure would not want to be denied the opportunity to apply just because I've been successful twice in a row, which were made, as it was, Bruce said, I was on the original local entity representing farm workers, which we were brushed aside, but was made by independent and analysts from outside the valley who evaluated those proposals, then brought to you for recommendation, the board that was here. They didn't evaluate the programs themselves. They were made by a point system by outside analysts both times, if I'm correct. Yeah, so I think that was pretty fair. Like I said, so I hope that isn't something that when you do come to finally adopt the request for proposal, that is eliminated. It's unfair and prejudicial. Also, I read in there, even individuals who were paid through a grant program. So if I have four employees that I hired through this program, now they're very experts in what they do. Now, if someone else were to run a... win a proposal, they would not be able to be on that project through another organization just because they had been successfully in my first operation the first 2 years. So that not only if you read the language, it doesn't say organization, also individuals paid by. That's pretty nitpicky and prejudicial in my opinion. Thank you.
Mr. Reyes, all the more reason why I want to take a look at this.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not sure I want to go where you want to go with this, but I do have a problem with number six, and I'll tell you why. These grants serve the public, and whenever you remove the grant, if they're deemed one of the top grants, then it's not so much the individual or the entity that you're punishing, it's those that's being served. And you know, when we originally set this up, this third was to go to farm workers, and there was an issue with the number of farm workers that came forward, so we moved towards this type of service. And there's many of these programs that do serve farm workers. They may not be out of jobs, but they do provide service to them. And so, you know, I think number six was really intended to target certain individuals, and I wouldn't approve of it.
Okay. Any other comments from the public?
Good evening. Martha and I are from Arbor, Imperial County. On the last two, 2008 and then in 2010, when we applied, we both times Arbor has applied under the workforce development and has placements that they have to meet. You know, and the last time around, we met at 104% of what we had stated that we would do on our performance. So on this time, the second time when we applied in 2010, we were asked to apply, not to apply for the same type of training, to bring some other type of training. So we did. We brought two different trainings into the Imperial County. All our trainings are under the medical field, which we all know is not going away. And this time around, we wanted to prepare, and we were working with other outside agencies from within the Imperial County and the Palm Springs area to bring other trainings into the Imperial Valley, which will benefit the community. So really would wish that you reconsider on the item number six. We, you know, we were wanting to bring in other trainings. It does help people. We will be training 55 people this in the 2010. That's what we proposed, and to bring in 42 jobs. So on this next time around, really wish that you would reconsider that.
Okay. Thank you. Any other public comments? Mr. Kuhn, I'll meet with you, and we'll discuss how this entity is set up and with Mr. Kelly to see if what we can put on the agenda to address your concerns.
I don't know that it'll go anywhere, but I'd sure like to try.
That's okay. We can address it. Okay. And then but I ask the board once again to please review this document for a future review for action sometime in the next 30 days, 60 days, Kevin. What are we looking at that?
Yes.
A couple questions, if I could.
Yes, Mr. Benson.
I just wondered if there's ever been an evaluation of the local entity grant recipients and ranking of how they've performed and use that in future funding. Because if you're knocking them out and you're knocking the best out, then how do we know what the future is going to be if they're all new?
I'm sorry. The way the program is established is their disbursements are based on attainment of outcomes. And in the 2008 program, we had five entities that received funds. Right. In the 2010 program, we have nine entities that have received funds. All of them have met their outcome, the attainment of their outcomes. All of them have performed according to what is in the proposal.
Are they audited, or is that just
audited.
The report they send you?
We audit their quarterly reports. They are obligated to submit quarterly reports. Also, when they come back and ask for the next disbursement of funds, we also review their documentation, make sure that the outcomes are being attained. If they do not meet 100% of their outcomes, the disbursement is not authorized.
Okay.
And then also the directly Craig from the auditing department also reviews their documentation and the outcome of their programs.
Okay. And then how many, how has the system ever been evaluated by those entities? So have they ever critiqued the way it's established? Do they have any way that they would want to change it? Ever ask them their opinion?
Well, they always have the opportunity to come before the board and if they find any issues.
Yeah, I guess maybe, I don't know if there was ever an opportunity for a workshop or something just to talk about how it's been done in the past, how it could be better done in the future, just to facilitate it quicker, faster, better.
Right.
Not take a lot of time, but. And how many people have applied in the past and how many received funding?
In the 2008 program, I believe we had about 15 submitted proposals.
Okay.
Of those, five were funded. In the 2010 program, I believe we had 21 or 22 proposals submitted. Nine of those were approved.
Okay.
In the first program, we had $1.2 million awarded. In the second program, we have $2.2 million that was awarded, or 2.1, just about that. As far as the outcomes that we will be attaining and that we are on track of attaining in the 2010 program, those would be 147 jobs created, 221 employment slots retained, 7,958 countywide residents served, 55 individuals receiving specialized vocational training, 89 businesses started, 25 business loans awarded, and 212 youth being provided job skill development. We are on track of hitting all those. In fact, we are in some cases, we are surpassing those, such as the case of Neighbor House that has far exceeded theirs, and also Eric Reyes' program. I think everybody's on track to surpass at one level or another what they have proposed.
Okay, then
so we're very happy with what they're
doing. Do we ever try to align this funding with other funding in the county so that they can receive it from two sides and actually grow to a bigger program?
We have asked them to try to use this fund. One of the purposes of the program is to use this as seed money to go after other grant funds. And, right. And also one of the scoring factors is being able to obtain cash match or in-kind match to the program to supplement
the
funds that we are
providing. They go get more money.
Right.
If I may, when I left this board,
I ended up on the board of directors of the Imperial Valley Food Bank. They were a recipient of this the last year, 2 years ago, and used that money to get matching funds. And I can tell you, even with the matching funds, hunger has not been eliminated in this valley. So I really would not like to see something like them cut out of this. If you have more people, perhaps they get less money, but they get something. And in the case of the food bank, I mean, again, I know I sat on that board for 7 years. And it was 2 years ago, I think, I had just gotten off when they got that grant from here. But boy, I was informed, I was let, you know, how much it was appreciated and blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, you know, I guess maybe it's just parts of the fruits of my labor that got me voted off this thing, but I'm sure glad it went to them. But I sure don't want to see, I would just not like to see entities such as that cut out of this. There's a need there, a big need.
One last comment. The first year was pretty experimental, I think. This second time around, in particular, matching dollars for dispersals, as Gustavo was saying, per outcomes is much better, makes it much tighter as an organization to make sure you're on your toes as well. You won't get that next dispersal. I mean, it matches up perfectly to every dollar you're spending to outcomes you said you're going to make. And it's much better, much tighter. I know the first go around maybe was not as finite. It was more numbers, not so much dollars spent per outcome, more numbers, and then you get your money. It's improved, and I think it can still improve.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Reyes.
I support your position, Mr. Reyes. I'd also like to see if we could ever put any scoring, if anyone ever gets involved in the water conservation program. I don't know if we can start businesses, but there's going to be a lot of money spent, and there's a lot of people with a lot of skills out there. So,
okay, any other comments on this issue? We're going to take a five-minute break, a little recess. We'll be back at 7:25.
Good. We'll be home about 1 o'clock.
Oh. Hold on. Oh.